Good morning and welcome to Garsington Opera's Monday Motivation. That was Photographs from Garsington Opera's 2010 production of A Midsummer Night's Dream by Benjamin Britten. It's a great production and that was the children's chorus singing, which was lovely to hear. Now this morning, I want you to think forest, enchantment and magic potions that can control who loves who. And there are fairies and sprites in this story, led by their gang leader, Puck. And here's a photograph just to get you in the mood of the kind of world we're in this morning. And you can tell they're quite mischievous, these sprites and fairies. And we have got with us this morning Natasha Kamjani, choreographer, and Richard Taylor, composer. And our guest artist is Henry Waddington, who I'm so pleased to have you with us this morning. Henry, how are you?
I'm very well. Good morning.
Good morning. And you are playing the role of Bottom in Midsummer Night's Dream for us this morning. And I'm interested to know why he has this rather interesting name.
Well, he's a low character, and he's the clown of the piece. He's also a weaver and spends a lot of the time probably sat at his loom, and probably over the years has developed rather a large posterior.
Oh, that's interesting to know. We've got a photograph of you in an Opera North production there. Was that a nice costume to wear?
That was a wonderful costume to wear. That's actually the play scene at the end where I'm playing Pyramus.
Ah, oh, interesting. Yeah. It looks really good fun. Well, we're looking forward to hearing you sing some of that role a bit later, Henry. So thanks for joining us. I am now going to pass over to Natasha, who's really going to get us moving and motivated on this Monday morning. Hi, Tash.
Good morning. Let's get our bottom motivated so they stay trim and toned. Here we go. All right, just breathing in for me. Stretch those arms up and out. Bring the legs a little bit further in and just take it into an easy bounce. Let your arms just flop about. Get ready to be fairies later on, so you can make them a little bit more wing-like. Let's go faster into your shoulders. You're really bouncing like nobody's watching, because they probably aren't. So have a nice little boogie. Good, we're going to take that into a march. Try and get your heart rate going. If it's okay with you, take it into a jog. If you don't want to jog, you just keep marching. Whatever works for you. If you can jog, get the legs up nice and high. Make sure you're not going to bump into anything. I can see my cat's having another moment. Take it into a gentle jack, if that's all right with you. If not, you can just take it like an easy side tap. If not, let's go and turn it round. Turning it round, keeping your chin down, your tummy in. Give me some slides. Sliding, and then take it anywhere around your room. Just sliding and gliding. Any animals you might have, any fairies, any creatures in your magical forest. Take it into your shoulders, but rolling them back. And you're trying to use more than just your shoulders, so it's your whole back moving. Take it into your arm, so it's a big circle, sweeping round. Let's go the other way, just single. Taking them up and over. Keep your knees bending. Your knees, really sink to the floor, and you're going to reach, that's it, keep your knees nice and soft, you're working your waist, side oblique muscles, just try that fast, are you ready, push, so you're really working these side muscles, pull up like someone, like a fairy's pulling you up by your ears, and you're going to go forward and back, so really opening up the chest, forward and back. Yeah, let me see that. Really curve. That's it. Really curve. Very good. Can you just go back? Like a funky fairy. Or a funky chicken. Good. We're going to go onto our hips. Bend your knees. Circling round. Circling round. And the other way. We've gone through every body part. I'm going to pass you back to Caramel. Two more breaths. Breathe in. Breathe out. One more deep breath in. Karen, are you ready? We're coming back. We're flying back to you.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, Tasha. We got really warmed up there. So everything in the story is the consequence of quite a big falling out between the king of the fairies, Oberon, and the queen, Titania. And the result of this is mistaken identities, confused couples, and quite alarming transformations. And Richard is going to take it a bit further into these fairies and sprites and introduce us to them, because during this story, in this opera, in Britain's version of Midsummer Night's Dream, they have an awful lot to say, don't they, Richard?
They have a lot to say, Karen. And as we all know, fairies and sprites are everywhere in the world all the time. The only difference in this opera is that we can see them on stage. So yes, the fairies and sprites pop up all the way through this opera. This whole story takes place surrounded by fairies and sprites. And they have a lot to say. And they have a lot of, they have a big job to do, really, in the opera. They tell us, they set the scene. And sometimes they comment on what's going on, but here they're going to set the scene for us. And it's a very it's a very beautiful landscape that they live in. And the tune that they sing really echoes that sort of sense of a hill and a valley. It's very beautiful. Now, it's great that it was a good warm-up, Tash, because we're going to need big lungs full of air this morning, because a lot of this the music that Britain writes needs big long breaths, big breaths to be able to get these long tunes out. So this is the first tune. Thanks, Karen, for the words. It goes, over hill, over dale, thorough brush, thorough briar. Brilliant, can you do that? Okay, here we go. Over hill, over dale, thorough brush, thorough briar. And it's thorough, so you pronounce it thorough. Let's do it with the music. Here we go. One, two, three. Over hill, over dale, thorough brush, thorough briar. That's fantastic. Same tune, different words. Over park, over pale, thorough flood, thorough fire. Brilliant actions, Tash. Let's go from over park. Here we go. Over park, over pale, thorough flood, thorough fire. And then my favourite line in the whole thing of tune, which goes, it's a nice little angular thing, and it goes, we do wander everywhere. So it's a lovely little sort of dotted tune. Let's try that. We do wander everywhere. Fabulous. Shall we ever go all the way from the beginning? You've got to take a really big breath. Watch Tash for the movements. Here we go. One, two. Over hill, over dale, over bog, over pale, thorough flood, thorough fire, we do wander everywhere. Well done, fabulous, thanks.
Fantastic, love it. So we're in this world of the forest, and hanging out in the forest, there's quite a lot of people. There's two couples who are trying to find each other. They're all running around. And there's also King Oberon and Puck, who are up to mischief because they're trying to confuse who loves who. And there's also Nick Bottom and his friends, who are rehearsing for a play that they hope will be part of a royal performance. Now, Henry, Bottom is struggling about what part to play, isn't he?
Oh, he wants to play every part.
Oh, why is that?
he's a show-off, and I think every part is deserving of his talent.
Oh, so he's very confident in himself then, that's good to hear. So before we find out which part Bottom eventually decides to play, we're going to go to Richard, because we're going to learn a response to what Henry is going to sing to us. So over to Richard.
We are, and I will let the cat out of the bag, because Henry wants to play Bottom, wants to play the part of a lion, because he thinks he can roar really well. And one of the other characters in the opera, one of Bottom's friends called Flute, tells him that really you shouldn't play this part, Bottom, because your roar is so big it's going to frighten everybody. And so Bottom's going to sing to us, Henry is going to sing his little bit explaining why he wants to play the part of the lion, and we're going to sing this response. I'll just sing it through, and it means you've got to have a really big lungs full of air, and you're going to sing quite high, but it's fine. Because it's first thing on a Monday morning, we can manage it. And it goes like this. And you should do it too terribly. You would fright the Duchess and the ladies, that they would shriek. Sheik! So it's quite high, but that's fine. And we've got to really tell him off with this. So this is the first line, it goes, and you should do it too terribly. Can you try that? Here we go, one, two. And you should do it too terribly. Brilliant. You would fright the Duchess and the ladies. Brilliant. So we've got the Duchess and the ladies. Thanks, Tash. You would fright. Here we go. You would fright the Duchess and the ladies. And this is where you need to take that really big gulp of air. That they would shriek. They would shriek. And it doesn't matter. Don't be afraid that it's high. Because although it's high, Benjamin Britten, who wrote the music, wrote it up there on purpose so it sounds like a shriek. So you should really go for it. Really shriek, tell him off. Okay, shall we do it one more time and then we'll ask Bottom to sing to us? Here we go. I'm gonna give you two notes in. This is what you listen for. And you should do it too terribly. You would fright the Duchess and the ladies, that they would shriek, they would shriek. Brilliant. Henry, do you want to sing us your little bit and we will see if we can adequately tell you off?
Yeah, okay. Let me play the lion too. I will roar that I will do any man's heart good to hear me. I will roar that I will make the Duke sing. Let him roar again. Let him roar again.
And you should do it too terribly. You would fright the Duchess and the ladies, that they would shriek, they would shriek. Brilliant. You feel thoroughly told off, Henry?
I think so, yeah.
Love that. I love the fact we're all shrieking this early in the morning. Brilliant. So Bottom and his friends, his companions, are still rehearsing this play, and Puck sees Bottom and he thinks, do you know what? I'm feeling really mischievous today, so I'm going to transform him. I told you there was some extraordinary transformations. I'm going to transform him into a donkey, an ass. And here is a photograph of Garsington's 2010 production, and you can see that there's a bed frame that makes up his nose and his eyes, which I think is fantastic, and then crutches for the front legs. It's a really, really clever design, that. Now, King Oberon squeezes the juice of a magic flower into his sleeping wife's, Titania's, eyes. Now, I told you before, this magic potion means that when she wakes up, the first face that she sees, she will fall in love with. So that's a little bit of a dangerous thing, because when she wakes up, the first face she sees is Bottom, and he's transformed into a, exactly, a donkey, an ass. So we had a very interesting design challenge this week, because we decided to explore this wonderful world of Midsummer Night's Dream in the forest. And the fairies, like I said, were really menacing at times. So we, with Rhiannon Newman Brown, we explored how you might make a costume design and out of things from nature. So if we look at this, this is an illustration of the woodland fairies that she started with. So this is Puck, Moth, Mustard Seed and Cobweb there. So she used that as an inspiration, and then got to this, which is where you go and create. You can see there on the side, the leaves and like little petals, bits of twigs that she's used as inspiration. And then it shows you how to then do a beautiful drawing from it. And we've got some people that did send in some designs. It's fantastic. We've got Andrew from Cardiff. Look at this fantastic design. That's so, so clever. Look at his little antlers there. And then we've got Maisie, who's 9, from Nottingham. Maisie, that is gorgeous. I just love it. What a fantastic idea there. So if you want to explore that even more and also see how it lifts off the page, check out our costume design session that we previously did, and also this design session on those costumes. And just go to our YouTube channel for that. Now, back to the fairies, who are very, very protective of the fairy queen, Natasha. And I really feel like we might need to learn a dance of how they protect and what their personalities are like.
Okay, we're going to be mischievous. So everybody, Legs apart, bend your knees. We're going to do a quick spin to your right. So you're going to spin around, spin, and when you land, try to make it a dynamic shape that takes on one of those characters. It could be Puck, could be Cobweb, whichever one you want. They go the other way, spin, and again, you land in a dynamic shape. Then we're going to reach up high. One arm up, one arm up, one arm side, one arm side, one arm down, one arm down, and hands on your hips, and give me like a little mischievous wiggle. Then we start the whole thing again, going the other way. Spin and land, other way. Spin and land, this time reaching up with the other arm. So reach up high, high, side, side, drop, drop, point, and then do me an end position, whichever fairy you've chosen or sprite you've chosen. One more time, and then we'll go with Richard on the music. So you've got spin and a land, spin and a land, high, high, side, side, low, low, hips, slight little wiggle, other way, spin and a land, spin and a land, other arm, high, high, side, side, low, low, point, end position. Richard, are you ready?
Well, I think so. I've got to live up to that fabulous movement. Here we go. Are you ready? Here we go. After three, one, two, three. That's it. Keep going. Fantastic.
Oh, yes, I'm loving it. And actually, Christoph Crespin has written into us to say that he's got lots of fairies and sprites in his garden. So I'm wondering if they might have joined in with that, Tash, this morning. Now, I told you these fairies are extremely menacing. So I'm going to hand over to Richard, who's going to explain that a little bit further in this next song.
Well, yeah, the fairies and sprites, they are, because they're looking after their lovely queen, they are telling all the animals that are in the countryside to behave themselves and not cause any kind of disruption to their beautiful sleeping queen, Titania. So they're asking the snakes to keep their tongues nice and still, the hedgehogs to keep their spines nice and contained, the newts and the blind worms, they've got, everything's got to stay very, very well behaved. Right, so there's a little challenge here. You've had design challenges, you've had movement challenges, and there's a little challenge here, and Karen's holding up some words that you'll see have various stars dotted among them. That's because we're all fairies and sprites, and we've got to imagine that we're dancing along stars this morning. That's easy to do. Let's first ignore the stars and we'll just learn the tune. And it goes like this. You spotted snakes with double tongue. Just try that. You spotted snakes with double tongue. Beautiful tune. The next line is the same, just drops down a bit. Thorny hedgehogs not be seen. And then the next line is the same, goes down a little bit, slightly changes at the end. Newts and blind worms do no wrong. So it goes up there. Let's try the newts and blind worms. Newts and blind worms do no wrong. And then the last bit is really nice. It goes, come not near our fairy queen. Okay, so far, so easy. You've been singing so much opera over the last weeks. What's difficult about this? Well, it's these stars, because you've got to make sure you leave room for the stars so that you've got the tune, the rhythm goes like this. You spotted snakes with double tongue, thorny hedgehogs be not seen. Newts and blind worms do no wrong. Come up near our fairy queen. So you see what I did? I chopped that tune up and stuck some little stars in there. Let's just give it a go. And Tash, it will help enormously. We've got movement as well. Fantastic. Shall we give it a go? Don't tread on those stars. Let them twinkle out in between the words. Here we go. I'll do some little star music so you avoid them. Here we go. One, two. You spotted snakes with double tongue, thorny hedgehogs be not seen. Newts and blind worms do no wrong. Come not near our fairy queen. Fabulous. Well done, everyone.
Perfect, beautiful singing. Thank you, Richard. Now, as we know, Titania, Queen Titania, is asleep, and it's because she's fallen in love with Bottom, who is actually a donkey. The first face she sees, she falls in love with. And Bottom wakes up from what he thinks is a dream, doesn't he, Henry?
Oh, yes.
And he sings a piece called Bottom's Dream. I wonder what's going on for him here.
Well, when he wakes up, the last thing he remembers, really, is he was rehearsing the play with his friends in the middle of the wood. But gradually he starts to remember something very, very strange that happened, something to do with looking like a donkey, something to do with a fairy queen. So he starts to sing, and as he tells us this story, he suddenly realises what a fantastic epilogue that would make for the play that he's doing for the Duke's wedding.
Ah, so we're now going to hear this aria, Bottom's Dream. So if you can spot where he starts to realise and gets these ideas as Henry's singing. Thanks, Henry.
God's me life, stolen hands and left me asleep. I have had a dream past the wit of man to say what dream it was. I thought I was. There is no man can tell what. Me thought I was. And me thought I had. But man is but an ass if he can offer to say what we thought I had. The eye of man hath not heard, the ear of man hath not seen. Man's hand is not able to taste, his tongue to conceive, nor his heart to report. What my dream was, what my dream was, my dream. I will get Peter Quince, the carpenter, to write a ballad of this dream, and it shall be called Bottom's Dream, Bottom's Dream, because it hath no bottom. And I will sing it in the latter end of the play, before the Duke. Peradventure, to make it the more gracious, I shall sing it at her death.
Wonderful, thank you, Henry. It's just such a treat for us to hear you sing that role to us. Is it a good role to play?
Wonderful role to play. It's actually one of my favourites. Yeah, it's great fun. I mean, there's normally a great team around you as well, which is, yeah.
Yeah, it's just, I can really see that in the way that you sang that to us. Thank you so much. It's been a real joy having you with us now. King Oberon, seeing his wife fall madly in love with a donkey, realises things have got a little bit out of hand. So he decides to make everything right. He gets those couples that were running around in the wood trying to find each other, and there's been lots of confusion there. He gets them back together, wakes them up. It's all fine. His wife is turned back to out of that potion spell she was in, and everybody is happy at the end. Now, of course, the fairies are going to have something to say about this, aren't they, Richard?
They are. The fairies get quite philosophical towards the end, and it's a really lovely ending. And it not only is it lovely musically, it's lovely in terms of words as well. And the words are poignant at this time for everybody, I think, given where we are and what's going on. So I'll just sing it through so you get the idea of it. Again, you need big lungs here. And it goes like this. Jack shall have Jill, Lord shall go ill, the man shall have his mare again, and all shall be well, all shall be well, all shall be well, shall be well. Really good. Right, beautiful. Let's learn it bit by bit. So, first line, Jack shall have Jill, we all know that. That nursery rhyme, and it's a sense of everything is coming together in the right order of things. So, Jack shall have Jill, naught shall go ill. Okay, if you got that, let's try that. Here we go. Thanks, Tash. Jack shall have Jill, naught shall go ill, and man shall have his mare again. His horse again. Man shall have his horse again. And man shall have his mare again. You've got to take a big, quick breath there. So it's mare again. Take a really big one. And all shall be well. All shall be well. Brilliant. Shall we go from the and all shall be well? Okay, Tash, here we go. And all shall be well. Shall be well. Another big breath for the very last line, which is one long breath. All shall be well, shall be well. Very nice. So there's a lovely sort of sense of settling down at the end. Let's just do the last all shall be well. So, oh, the last two. So the last three lines there. Here we go. All shall be well, shall be well. Gorgeous. Are we ready to do the whole thing? Take a really good breath in and breathe out. That's it. Fantastic. Here we go. Jack shall have Jill. Thanks, Tash. One, two, three.
Jack shall have Jill. Lord shall go ill. The man shall have his mare again. And
going to be well in the world.
All's going to be well. I feel like that definitely should be our song for the week. I'm going to definitely be keeping singing it. Thank you so much. What a lovely way to end Monday Motivation this morning. And thank you to Henry Waddington, our wonderful guest this morning. It's been absolutely gorgeous to have you. And thanks, of course, to Richard and Natasha. Now, I'm just going to quickly tell you about some exciting news, because next week is our final Garsington Opera Monday Motivation. And we are going to be live at Garsington Opera on their stage. So do tune in for that one, because it's going to be a really exciting finale to a wonderful, wonderful time we've had with you during quite a challenging time for most of us, I think. So thanks so much for being with us. Head over to our partners Opera Vision if you want to watch the full-length opera. They've got it over there. And goodbye for now. Have a great week. Bye, everyone.